So welcome to the session, Smart Cities. We have about an hour and 20 minutes, so we have time. We also hope that this session will be a bit interactive, so if you have questions, please raise them. We have four guests today. Rob van Gijzel is the mayor of Eindhoven. You heard him yesterday. Charles Lin, deputy mayor of Taipei City. Mr. Tan Kokyam is the head of Smart Nation Program in Singapore. And Trent Mayberry, stationed here in Singapore and head of design for Accenture Global. And I'm Rob van Kranenburg, and I founded a think tank for Internet of Things. It's been trying to bridge more technical and social issues in Internet of Things and smart cities for the past past decade. I hope we will have a good discussion. I think so, and would like to kick off with Mr. Charles Lin, yeah, who has a slide set for us. Yeah. So, Mr. Charles, if you please could. So, Lin, okay.
Well, Robert, thank you. I'm Charles Lin, the deputy mayor of Taipei City. Well, maybe I can use the 10 or 15 minutes to share with you the blueprint of the smart city, what the city has been doing. Well, it's quite same with you. Well, this is the outline. Just take you 10 or 15 minutes. We are always in the same situation as you are. So the city always challenges the new issues, including the aging society, and also the facing the problems of the air pollution, and also the city need to have the more public housing. So go smart, it becomes a new global trend. Never doubt it, no one doubt it, the smart city. As we know, there's more than 1,000 cities. They proclaim they are moving their city to a smart city. But thing is, how to be go smart, and what is the role of the city government can do? So maybe this is what I can share with you. Well, taking the Taipei as the status that we have there some advantage in terms of making the city smarter. That we have the people they are quite accessible to using the internet. And also the city is quite of the full of talent, and the city has been ranked as the very e-smart, I mean in terms of the government governance. So this is the why we are trying to have the taking a good advantage of Taipei. Especially we have the most important things, the ICT industry in Taiwan, especially located in Taipei, is the home base of the industry of the whole Taiwan. And there will be the quite convenience for the city to mobilize all the entrepreneurships to work with the city. So this is our advantage. So I was appointed, and I also outlined the blueprint for the city to engage to launch the program of the Smart City of Taipei. You can see this is totally a structure that the Smart City Committee will be chaired and already be chaired by the city mayors. And I was politically appointed as the chairman of the Taipei City Smart Office. It's kind of a PMO project office. I put in this, it means the committee about that, there will be the policy making and also join the blueprints for the next steps and the current step the city should move ahead. But as a chairman of the Smart City, I put in up the PMO. Well, before go further, that is, we also have the 31 agency within the city government structure. It's a huge. We also have the Department of Information Technology within the Taipei City Government Administrations. But the way I'm trying to see the PMO is the not the extension of the departments of the information technology. It's the totally, it's not an extension of the bureaucracy. So I call for more talents and the more liaison with the enterprise. So I set up the project office. The purpose of that will be the, as I have mentioned to you, the purpose of the Smart City PMO, I put in a mission to them. One, there were three missions. One mission is taking out the need including the present and for the future. The need can be transferred into the new public service and can be transferred into, converts into the new business model. The second mission I want the PMO to do is the become a matchmaker in terms of a technology apply, and a matchmaker of the financing. The third thing is the become a most important platform to build up the international compatibility. That would be the cooperate with more academic society and more entrepreneurships. As the city will commit to be driven of the living lab, so they can take the mission one and two and become a Taipei one to provide a new solution to the whole world. So this is the way I'm doing, and the PMO is getting started. And I set up the I hope the have their more discussion with the entrepreneur. There were four aspects of the Taipei city in terms of making the city go smarter. One thing is the smart government. The second aspect is the covering the city citizen. The smart city is not a goal, it's a means. But the most important mission is to make your citizen smarter. So the people-centric is the one of the mission, and that we are covering the aspects of the smart city. And the third thing is the it's a compulsory obligation, and also is a necessary obligation that the government can do is to provide the better smart infrastructure. And the fourth thing is the we are trying to put the things of the Taipei as a real smart living labs. So according to that, the thing is going to this one. Smart governments. Well, Taipei City, as the other city of the Taiwan, they are being ranked starting 2001. There was the most efficient e-government in the whole world. But Taipei is going further. It's not only the e-government, but somehow the smart government. So in terms of that, we are doing lots of efforts that the putting lots of information visualization and putting lots of infographics that we would like to allow the people to understand the government can do in terms of a better service. A smart citizen. Well, so this morning I have a talk with some guys from the IDC. I'm saying they are taking my example, my personal example. My mother is 85 years old in Taipei. She live alone. She's quite wealthy. And also she is capable of using the iPhone as I do. So she can live alone. So according to the apps the government provide, she is quite easy to assess the way he wants to go shopping. And she also can live along with the, he can know the schedule of the bus. So I just spend one day a week with my family to have a dinner with my mom. But I have very easy to know what happened to her. So I'm saying this is the most important thing, the goal of the smart city is to make your citizen more smarter. And they can easy to use the advice, and they can easy to get a service from the city government. And the third aspect is smart infrastructure. No doubt at all. Taipei Wi-Fi networks, right now it's become more than 9,000 accessible points. So the people have been easy to use it, free. If necessary, free. And the second thing is we also have to have the public works by ways of build up the 3D road pipelines. Well, this is quite critical for the city of, we guarantee to have two more years to build up the within our jurisdictions. Underground pipeline will be visualized, and that was not only for the purpose of visualizations, but a purpose for the disaster prevention, and it makes much more integration by ways of digging the road. That was much more impossible for the city of Taipei. We are doing this. And then we have the most important thing is to make the transportation smarter. So this is one of the examples that we move ahead the smart solutions that the city government are spending lots of money for bringing the young people back from the outskirts of the city to go back the inner side of the Taipei. So taking this one is, for example, we guarantee to have the 900 million US dollars to put in on the 6,000 public housing units by the end of this year. Well, we guarantee to have the 20,000 public housing by the years of 2018. And 6,000 of the 20,000 will be built up as a smart public housing. And that will be the becomes up the new challenge and the new proposal. So you can see this is the drawing and the constructions. So we promise that it's not only the construction fee we are guaranteed to have, an additional 3 to 5% as experimental actions that we call for proposal from the ICT to go in with the architect and they go in with the general contractor. So it becomes the most progressive way we are doing this. But what's the purpose of that and what is the content of the public housing? I mean, the public housing is not for sale. It's permanently owned by the city government and it's been well built. But somehow we are trying to implement the way a smart grid. And some of this way, you can see the from the beams, from the hams to the beams to the smart grid. And also it's become a new integration that the city government can go with the power, the power company, and it becomes as a demand supply. And taking this, one of the examples have been really built up for the one of the smart community. You can see each department, the public housing community, they provide a U-car, car sharings, and they also have a smart grid and smart meters. And taking this one for example, especially we are facing a new problem of the aging society. Taipei has been evaluated as the most elderly city in Taiwan. The population for the more than 65 years old is the 14%. I don't know how much the percentage of in Singapore. Sooner or later, I will be one of the member of the club. So it become more important thing is to provide the health care in the public housing. In a way, we are not only in the public housing. We try to move some elder people, part of them, to use in the public housing, and then they can lease the house to the city. And the city government can make much more, low rental to the young people. So it becomes a social measurement in terms of the make the city smaller. So one of the projects that as a living lab in Taipei, we starting have this one, and it's gonna be launched the program. I also call for the international corporations, not only for the domestic ICT provider or IoT providers. The smart station, this is the Taipei main station. We're gonna be launched the programs, a call for proposal starting from the 1st of the June. Taking this one is the passenger of the Taipei main station is up to the 500,000 per day. And the end of this year, there will be a city link to the airport. So it becomes of more than 10 to 12 different modes of transportation concentrate in the Taipei main station area. So it's quite necessary if we want to have withstand the terrorism and the disaster. So the city government launched the program, smart station programs. So you can see there was automatic, parking management and also the detection of the system of the integrated. This is most popular one, this U-bike. And it has reached to the 94% of satisfaction rate. And that would be the incredible things that the city government promotes only the 4 years. Within the 4 years, there will be more than 8 trips per day per bike. And right now we stayed up to the 2018, up to the 400 stations. And it comes up the 13,000 bikes daily used. And Giant is one of the enterprise, they own the system. And we bought it and we cooperate with a Giant. So the further steps is we're going to the smart scooter and the smart car sharing. So this is one of the program we're gonna be launched at. And the thing is we open all the public lots. And 700 to the 1,000 car sharing is prepared. We are launched the program in the middle of this year. And the EV is much more welcome to the proposal. And it's not only within the jurisdiction of Taipei. We are cooperate with the neighboring municipality. So from the Keelung to the Hsinchu, there will be a suitable scale up to the more than 5 million. Well, the population of the Taipei is 2.7 million, but in the daytime, there were more than 600 million within the neighboring city. So it become a most popular way to use in the U-bike, to the U-scooter, and to the U-car. So the thing is not only the things, I think the most important things, the IoT is the most important things by ways of building the city smart. So we also have some implementations for the experimentals. IoT ecosystem. So we're using the base stations such as LoRa, and even the French, they have the Sigfox. We also welcome them. So you can see this is one of the IoT city-wide developments. We provide a platform. and we open the city test bed for all the corporation, for all the ICT providers. So we are not limited to any kind of a protocol, but we use in the Rora, we also use in the different kinds of the significance included. So you can see, this is one of the, I want to show you, quite similar to the Amsterdam. So we use in the beta cooperation with ASUS, so one of the famous the IC providers, and it become a cooperation with ASUS computing company. Airbox, we got a 300 Airbox, so it will be sent to the elementary school, and Airbox is collecting all the data, including the PM 2.5, and the temperature and the humidity. So as the data can be obtained, computerized, and visualizations, and there were a lot of people to do more things. So this is the way. So let me give you I want to jump up the conclusions that the important thing is that we don't know what kind of to measure the city smart, but we understand that if we can turn up the public service and make a business, that will be make our city to much more go smarter. So the first step is the public environment is quite necessary. We are digging out the need, not only for the present, but for the future. So that will become a new style. The second thing is the how can we speed it, the matching and the linking industry. The way is the, I'm always thinking is the city government is quite limited in terms of resources, but we open it. And it's not only the data open, but the fear. So if the city guarantee to have their test bed, all the city as a living lot, so that will be much easier for the, especially I personally not recognized. Smart city is a new business, but without governments, I don't think there will be a new business because it's not a product oriented, it's a total service package oriented. So what they need is the test bed. And that was the best thing that the government can do. So in this case, I'm showing the sharing with the what we have done. I don't know whether we were successful, but I always commit and I always notice that the moving ahead, and that will be get the city smart. Thank you very much. Okay.
Thank you. If there's any sort of urgent questions from the audience, we'll take it. Otherwise, I would rather sort of maybe ask Mr. Tan to talk about his experience with Smart Nation Singapore, a little bit maybe sort of where it came from, sort of what the vision was, what the vision is now. We've heard, of course, yesterday from the minister, and we know that there's a strong vision. But the implementation, of course, is the key, and this is where you are coming in. So please take it.
So thank you. When my minister gives a speech, I mean to everybody else it's a speech, but to my colleagues and I, it's like an assignment, right? Because the implementation is important. I mean, I really like your presentation, and maybe in terms of implementation, let me just focus on two kind of dimensions to see this, and it has a little bit of it echoes a little bit of what you said in your presentation. The first is the need to integrate and rally industry, government agencies, data owners, database owners, people who can create software and so on, skills and talents, and you need to integrate them towards achieving something that has meaning for the average citizen. In the areas of transportation, mobility, in the areas of improving the home and the environment, in business productivity, because that's important for us. We don't have that many people. In health and aging, of course, we are both of us are not just us aging. I mean, but our citizenry is aging. And finally, in the bread and butter of government work, which is a delivery of our government services and so on. So in these verticals, we want to integrate. And you want to bring people together and rally the effort to make sure that we move the needle in these areas. So that's one challenge of implementation. But the second challenge, and there's a tension to this, is about building the horizontals and being able to have that ecosystem where, you know, the person with an idea matches up with the company, with the wherewithal to deploy, and the database with the correct data, and another set of people with the skills and talents, and make things happen that surprises all of us. And that's the spirit behind open data and so on and so forth. And that's building the horizontals. Even as we integrate people and effort towards achieving the verticals, we are also building the horizontals and as a more sustainable way to build a smart nation, to build smart cities and so on. That must be the way ahead, beyond the projects and the individual programs. So that those are the two challenges just of implementation that we face.
So basically, it's also about balancing what you can show for value for citizens, which they immediately sort of see with like smart parking, smart lighting, sort of the use cases that we are familiar with. But then there's the other part, which is basically saying that globally we spill about 50% of our food gets wasted. I think in London, 30% of the water sort of is going down the drain. So we have a huge, huge leakage of resources. And without monitoring these in a kind of good way, which is not immediately shown as value for citizens, but it's in the back. Without sort of showing this, so we need to balance the story for the citizens with the balance with the back end, as to say.
Yeah, absolutely, and it's not even about the smart light or the smart screen and so on and so forth. It's about, can I shave 3 minutes off your commute, your daily commute, even if 3 minutes is low, it's something that has impact on me as a citizen. Can I have applications and IoT applications that monitor a frail elderly member in the home that allows people to respond when during an emergency medical situation? And those things save lives. There's a number of lives saved. There's a number of minutes taken off your daily commute. That's important to the individual, and we have to focus on this, because when you tell people that you have open data and come and co-create with us and so on, you have to tell them what you want them to co-create to. What is the objective of all this? And it's not just the shiny technological toys, it's about things that really make a difference.
Mr. Gijzel? So where do you think we are at this stage? Are we still in a stage of like shiny new things, or are we beginning to show real value for citizens?
That depends on where you're looking in the world. But maybe I divide on the developments on two sides. The first one is we see new technology coming up, and it's making the life of people more convenient. You can say sometimes it's gadgets, like, well, to help you to find a parking lot or that kind of things. That will go on, no problem. People will buy it or not, and they will be in favor of these new applications. The most significant thing is, for me as a mayor of the city, is how can we change the grand challenges of the world? How can we solve them? And then we talk about completely other different things than these sketches. Then we talk about, wow, how can we organize the energy supply in the world on another way than we did in the past, so that we are circular as well? What can we do with food and food security? And how can we organize that in huge cities, like in Singapore or in Shanghai or other cities, that people can get a daily food without that we have huge transport costs and a lack of energy that we have to use to bring the stuff there, insecticides, pesticides, that kind of things. So there are several huge challenges in the world, health, new educational system. And as far as I can see, when you look to these systems, then we can see as local governments that they are outdated and that we will not succeed. And I told yesterday the audience as well, as a national government, from the level of a national government, the traditional instrument, a toolkit, they cannot solve. They can even not be a partner on a specific way in this process. And why am I saying so? Because the traditional toolkit of a government, and I'm not talking about Singapore, because you got a completely different situation. But in 99% of the world, it's just like I'm saying, we got three levels of governance. And then the national government is always doing things with regulations and legislations. And this is something what we see in the disruptive world, that you cannot do it top-down anymore. You have to do it with other stakeholders. There is no politician, or hardly any politician, that can tell you that he understands exactly what is coming up with the disruptive technology we are facing on this moment. How can he or she make the legislation? That will be impossible. So there must be a specific awareness, collaboration together, that we understand better from each other what is beneficial for the people, what will be commercially interesting. And that is something that we have to start, what I would say, don't take standpoints, but look to the interests. What is the interest of the commercial side? What is the interest, what the beneficial side for society? What is the interest for the planet itself, for the citizens, and bring them together and then find new solutions? I do not have the answers, the final answer, and I don't give them because they do not exist. If someone knows exactly how the world will appear within 5 years, well, stand up, raise up, and tell me.
Well, actually, we have that person on the panel because Trent Mayberry, he's from Solution Design. So actually,
I'm very curious.
So maybe Trent Mayberry. So maybe allow just a bit, but maybe sort of. So you specifically say solution design.
Yeah.
So it means that you have an awareness of what the problem is. And so
there's not the problem ultimately is there's not a single problem to solve, right? There's lots of challenges to face. The solution design model that I'm talking about is really trying to understand what are some of the goals, what are some of the real needs and challenges, and then make sure we find a solution that's appropriate at the cost level, has the right level of impact and take up. And if I look at the statistics, over half the world's population is going to be in a city by 2020. So we have so many people in that environment, and that's going to put a lot of strain on our resources, on our quality of life, on lots of things. So I think the focus around solutions is multidimensional. Some of it's about quality of life. Do I have a better commute? Do I have better food safety? Do I have better impact on the environment and the world? Some of it's more economic, which is how do I attract businesses and companies that can actually help me continue to invest and develop and grow, particularly as my cities grow. Some of them are a bit more altruistic, and I think we're, you know, this concept we're talking about around the smart city is a recognition that if half the world's population is here, that's where we got to start solving the real problems and the real challenges, but they are multidimensional.
Yes, I guess the message we're getting from you, Mr. Mayor, is that even saying very strongly, like the government cannot even be a partner somehow, right? So what you said, that's, so it seems to be like you're saying, we have a situation where we have stakeholders that used to have and still have lots of agency. They have a toolkit that's out of date. They're solving yesterday's problems. We are acknowledging that we are in the network. You also referred to Manuel Castells and the network society. I think for me, I understand that with a very simple story. It's like the book was available, was the book, the Gutenberg Bible was available in 1452. So in 1452 in Europe, we had the book, the potential to print. We had 3 million people in Europe then. We had 60,000 people in London. And if the kings and the queens would have wanted, they could have made everybody literate by 1500. We would have had a very nice society in a way, but they didn't. So the first public library in Holland, who only got there by one man pushing in Den Haag, in The Hague, was in 1918. So power is able to stall distributing and distributed learning technology for over 400 years. Because it doesn't really want everybody to read, doesn't want everybody to get literate, doesn't want everybody to get access to the same tools. Now we talk about the internet. Well, the internet, let's say, is 50, 60 years old, but the browser, which is, as most people know, the internet, the World Wide Web, is from Mosaic, is 1993. So December 1993, we have the first browser coming out. We're now 2016. So in 23 years, every single human operation, every business, every infrastructure, everything that we are doing, has been changed dramatically by this protocol, TCP/IP, which basically says pass on the package, don't care where it comes from, don't care where it goes to, just move. It's all about speed. And this speed has been really changing also different and empowering different intelligences who have been not getting the kind of data that they got in 1600 or 1700, where if you would ask them to read a book, they would put you in jail or hang you, sort of like. So this is what we are facing. All these institutions that we talk about are tuned to the book. They're tuned to having to stalling all this innovation, and their very mode of being was that they had the quality to stall. That was their quality, and all these all these institutions and their tools are tuned to this book sort of reality. That's now gone. So they are not even in the web reality. Now we get Internet of Things. This internet, which then is only 23 years old for most people in terms of the browser, which was only about linking up discrete devices like computers and laptops, is now going to link up coffee machines, lantern poles, any type of object that you can think of, in basically two ways. So either it's going to put IP addresses into anything that holds a little bit of software, or it's going to link up all objects in terms of radio frequency identification, QR codes, barcodes, and near-field communication. So we are already in a world in which every object is identifiable, and any other object that has a little bit of software will have an IP address. So this is going to break fully.
Yeah, but it's not the first disruptive time. You are doing it yourself from the book at that time in the Middle Ages in Europe. Nothing happened in the meanwhile. But what we have seen, of course, that the guild, who could organize themselves, could take over the power from the noblemen. Yeah. And then later on, I see three huge emancipation moments in the European history. The first one is the guild. The second one is that people could get access to the writing and reading, and that they could get new information by radio and television. And at once, the whole world was there. They couldn't connect with the world in that moment, but they knew about the world and what was going on. And that happened that politicians couldn't just say anything anymore, because, and they were not completely in control, because there was free information at the moment. And the third one is now what we are seeing is that well-educated people, entrepreneurial people, do have contact with other people that was until now only available for the national governments. Yeah. So you can make your own network in your own society, and that's a real breakthrough on this very moment. Yeah. But when we look to, and this is the IoT Congress, I'm looking to smart cities, I already told you a little bit. When I look to IoT, then something we think, well, everything will connect it. It is the internet of everything. But then it's good to look where are the best examples and where will it be beneficial. There's a report I referred yesterday of McKinsey, and they are saying that you got, well, one, two, three, well, you got the domain of the human body. So that's with wearables and that kind of things, that you can keep your health on level. There are all kinds of things, sensors in your body. The second one is the home situation. The third one is retail environment. The fourth one is offices. Then we come to factories, work sites, vehicles, cities, and outside. And the only three that are of highest importance because of using Internet of Things, and that again gives us a very high profit, is factories, cities, and outside. And we think we can all do all these domains. That's true. But if you want to pick out your priorities, then choose these. And then I come to some requirements that's necessary. Where are the enablers and the barriers? And they say, and that's very key on looking to what do we see when we want to implement IoT. And then they say there is the field of technology. We see that the costs of MEMS sensors are still too high. So they have to be dropped down. Will it be effectively used in all kind of application, in especially when we talk about factories? The interoperability is a key to get. And when you look to the industry, for example, then the connection in the line between the fourth and the third and the second and the first tier is really important. Privacy and confidentiality. That's a point that we do not have organized until now. And confidentiality is, of course, on security as well. I was this morning at a technological university. We were talking there with NXP. Do you know that when we got an autonomous car, that someone is, can take over the control of your car and just drive it aside. Well, we got all kind of examples for problems, but what you see, I gave yesterday the example that a very wealthy American guy who had to do a surgery on his heart, it was a vital surgery, he received a message a couple of days before that if he would not make an amount of money to a certain person, that they will interfere in a surgery process. So there are all kinds of threats as well. Intellect property we have not organized. And do we have enough talent to organize this whole system? And the last one is public policy. So when you take these all, there are quite a lot of items we have not well organized until this moment. So we need some time. And this is, we are talking about a world system, yeah, a globe system. And that means that we need to adjust with between not all the stakeholders in my own country, but between all the stakeholders worldwide. And so that will have to bring us to standards and that kind of things. Well, we have to do something together still.
So it's quite revolutionary, I guess. So that's what we need. And so are you proposing a kind of silent takeover by the mayors of this world, by the city, sort of?
My good friend Benjamin Barber wrote a book about if mayors would rule the world would have been far more better. And the reason for that is that he is saying mayors, and it's symbolic, mayors, he is talking about public authorities. But what he is saying, that on that level, pragmatism is more key than ideology. So what I see on national governments, France, Germany, England, see what is going on with the Brexit, or in the Netherlands, or the United States, see what's going on with Trump. Do you really think that it's helpful what Trump is saying? This is pure politics, it's pure, well, let's say, ideology and a lot of talk, so, but it doesn't help us. And we
can I see
are
some hands about, so can I see some hands about that? Who thinks it's helpful what Trump is saying? Okay, actually, no hands at all. So
okay, but we are responsible for a safe, secure city. We are responsible for good mobility, public transport systems. We are responsible for a good education system. And it's the national government, in most of the cases, that is more or less blocking this development. So we are here, we are having a very severe problem with our way of government organizations worldwide without Singapore. Singapore is a little bit different. They got another problem as well. But this is, well, they do not have three layers, and it costs a lot of energy to get them in one line. And then the government must be a partner, more or less equal partner, but then from the public domain with the other stakeholders.
Yeah, so you want to reply to this?
Yeah, you make me feel good about my job. But I know, to your point about this revolution, I think about one and a half decades ago, we have the term a garden city. We want to make Singapore a garden city, which means you set aside land and you say, okay, let's build gardens, let's build nice parks and gardens. And then we sort of changed it a bit, quite a bit actually, and we decided to use the term city in a garden, which is, well, it's a bit of a marketing thing, but it's also a difference in approach, that you no longer set aside little spaces for the gardeners to garden and the park people to build a park, whatever that means. But you plan the whole city so that it looks like you are in the midst of a garden. You ensure there's connectivity across gardens and parks and green spaces and so on. And I think that's the difference. It's no longer an internet community. You don't go to a land gaming shop to access the internet. It's all over us. IoT is going to be all over things that are surrounding us. So it's almost like we are now a society in an internet, not just an internet society. And this is why I think governments, mayors, you know, people who are not the gardeners, people who are not involved before, now have to be really involved, because it's about the design of the whole structure, the design of the whole system around these enablers that technology has given us.
But you, maybe may I raise a question? I didn't until the last, I didn't did do this the last couple of days. But what I see, you do a great job, but you are planning everything. And as far as I can see, you started to plan the life of people as well. And that's something in Western Europe. In Western Europe, we do look on another way to this issue. It's vulnerable. I see it's sensitive. But how far do we go into the situation, on the private situation. How far do you think that we can go with all kinds of new technologies?
Yeah, well, I can't even plan my own life. My wife does that kind of. So, but I think you've made a point about the degree of information, the granularity of the planning and so on, and I think as far as data, being able to use big data, being able to apply the different the collated data of different people is concerned, I think we have to be quite clear that we are using it to meet certain objectives, to make the traffic flow faster, to keep the environment safe and so on. And those are the things that you do have to do some planning.
Sure, but we are doing that as well. Mm. The question is, how far are you going to interfere in the private situation of people? That's the question we all got. We got all kind of data within a couple of years. And are we going to protect the privacy, or are we going, as a government, going to use all this data to put people in control? This is a discussion in Songdo and Masdar as well. So what we see is, I can organize a society in completely control. Well, within 20 years, 25 years, I don't know when, but that will be possible. Is this the goal we are looking for, or is it that we want to have a society, a reluctant society, where people have a pleasant life and that, well, they can control their own life, but they are supported by the government to do the things that they really want, that they really have chosen for?
I mean, of course,
yes, but the balance of openness and control, right, and finding that balance. But you also say we are just beginning. So the trouble is, at the moment, we don't have really educated people in the government, because I agree with you fully. I've been talking to, in Holland, I've been talking to the Ministry of finance, police, and the police innovation people, and the Justice Department for a very, very long time, and they're beginning to understand the dramatic nature of the change, but they're still not educated. But also, the audience in the street is also not educated. So we have this very strange moment, which is really a new situation, where we have no educated demand, and we really also don't have like an educated.
That's why we try to do, and of course it's not always correct, but we try to involve people in new developments. We ask them what is your ideas, your interests, your demands. How can we bed it in? Because otherwise, and they do not understand everything and from the start. But when corporates are coming in and they say, we can provide you this, is this something you want? We are looking from the public side, is this of public interest? We have a debate about it, and then we are going to implement and try to find out. Of it will help or not, and sometimes there will be a failure.
So, at what level of the discussions do you come in with your solutions? Do you come in at the level of like these governments asking these big questions, or is it more on corporate level, or is it more on like the city level in the?
So I actually see a mix. I think, you know, your comment earlier about can anyone plan everything that's going to go forward? I think that's a hard thing, because the amount of opportunities, the amount of change is pretty high. I think we get in very early to help people shape what's the vision about what's possible. And what's possible today economically is going to be very different than what's possible in 5 years' time as the costs drop and the accessibility goes up. But we help first shape a vision, a goal about what are some of the things that we can do. Then we help organizations, both governments and companies, figure out what are the outcomes that actually help us confirm that we achieve those goals. And those need to be measurable. And the good news with IoT is everything's measurable. And if you can measure it, you can manage it. So we want them to actually help shape those outcomes. And then we talk about, well, how do you achieve it? Because I think early on we made a mention, in the end, while everything's possible, it's really about who executes it, who implements it. And I think working through the secret sauce around implementation is key. And it won't be a single organization or a single government that actually drives a successful execution. I think it's going to be a collaboration. What we've seen early on in the smart city space is very vertical solutions around very specific issues, smart grid, smart water, you know, smart transport, etc. They're fairly independent and a little bit isolated, but they help solve point problems. But what we're seeing now in terms of trends is emerge to this more horizontal model that says, let's create an enabler. And part of the government's job is to facilitate that enablement so that more people can participate. And I think that's pretty key. So we're helping them start to think about the architecture of that. The one other comment I'll say is, even if we got all the technology out there and we got those solutions laid out in place, people may not actually leverage it if we don't get the design and the user experience right. If we can't make this actually accessible, easy to do your, you know, faster transport or better access to your health, or actually create an experience that makes it easy for people to participate, we'll still not get that uptake. And so implementation's about both architecture and uptake of people, which is a people problem.
I think what we also see is that at one point, I think sort of there's huge, huge, huge potential for real disruption in the space. And I mean breakdown.
Yeah.
And so we've not really managed to orchestrate or design breakdown, right, to a certain extent. So even with your solution and design solutions, you're still catering to a lot of old situations that people want to keep sort of afloat, because that's basically what we know that's going on. Whereas what we've seen from the web in the past 20 years, if massive players coming up in under 10, 15, 20 years, like Facebook, harvesting most data of people in the world, Google, Amazon, moving extremely fast, harvesting basically all the data around. In Europe, 50% of all the services people use are in the hands of over-the-top players from America. So we don't even, our governments have no, are not protecting our data in their own databases or data sets, basically, somehow, right? See, so this coupled with the drive that's in Internet of Things and with the connectivity that is moving very fast now, we will see over-the-top players coming on energy. I think there's already one in the States called Sungevity that's selling solar and battery meshed in together. And so we'll see a lot of, and we are seeing a lot of...
experiments.
Sort of, yeah, experiments and over-the-top players moving around in these spaces that are actually already becoming new entities. And these new entities are sort of governed with their own sort of governance structure. And they really don't really care anymore about what the governments are doing or saying. And if we look at Europe, only thing we can do is fine these people, which is not, I think, the right attitude that we can have. So the thing is, what we all see is that basically the tooling that we do is tuned to a kind of old situation. So if you take your analysis to the top, to the hilt, so to say, or if you take it very further, then will you be still mayor in 2 or 3 or 5 years, or where will you be?
Even that I cannot predict. No, I can't predict it, because I'm going to step down on the 1st of September this year, voluntarily. I wanted to do something else.
That's a logical conclusion, basically.
Yeah, sure.
It's a bit sad also, if you want to say, because you really understand everything very strongly. So
yeah, maybe. Well, I've done this for 8 years, and I really think that you must not do this for 15 or 20 years, because then you are, as a mayor, you can give a push in the beginning, but you are going to block when you are too long on the same post.
I wouldn't say that you're blocking at the moment.
No,
I would say this is exactly the moment where you understand the basic situations.
Yeah.
So I hope you will reconsider this.
No, I won't.
This
no,
decision.
I won't. Now I lost the question.
Okay, that's a bit moving back. No, but in terms of, we go to Taipei sort of, what are the main problems that you face in Taipei when you hear all these issues about this governance?
Well, in terms of the governance there, I want to get some response to what you mentioned, not only for the Taipei. What's the purpose for the smart city? I think that the government play a role, is not a planner for the smart city, but somehow facilitating. So people can, government do not have the duty, and government do not have the obligation to design for the people's life. But what the government's role is try to promote the better service, deliver, especially in terms of the using the IoT. So this is the concept that the Taipei City is going to. And in terms of using the IoT, I think the IoT is they have two aspects. One thing is the most beautiful invention, IoT, everything can be connected. And I also recognize IoT is going to be a most dangerous weapon in terms of the nationality to control all the people's information. So there were two aspects. But I always look on the bright side. That I'm saying I'm the urban designer and architect, physical architect. So I'm saying that last century, the concept of the city governance is based on the form follow functions. Now if you provide the function and then you decide a form, the form follow functions. But 21st century, I'm saying there, form follow mobility and connectivity, especially not a function, because all the information can be connected. All the information as a flow, mobility flow. So it becomes a new style of governance. So what will be the position that the government should focus on? I am a person that 100% would like to approach the smart city programs initiatives. But the way is the look very careful about the IoT. It's a very successful invention to put all the things connected. But always you have to look on the black side. Because all information can be collected, computerized, and used it by different people. So what we do is they will still have some measurement, some agreement that the government and the national government and the local government and the different government have some more agreement that how should we use the information. So finally, I want to go back to the Taipei. Well, we are have been ranked as some UK magazine that Taiwan is one of the most advanced in terms of open data. So have been ranked for the recent years. Taipei is one of the most open data governments in Taiwan. So we are having already more than 70 million accessibility for the people to easy to get information from the different agency from the Taipei city government. And we always use the free. But we are looking forward to come back as a benefit to the government and government can turn into the better service for the citizen. So who will get the benefit from that? Who will get the benefit from that? I mean, part of the top level of the Silicon Valley, they also can get that because it's easy for the Google to use that. So I'm saying the problem right now we are doing is we don't know what will be happen for the next 2 years. I mean, in terms of technology evolutions. We don't know at all. But we certainly know that we should keep more cooperation with the entrepreneur because they are always having the good best products and they will always have the Taiwan is the most famous islands that we have the most of the invisible champions in Taiwan, including Advantech, Asus, Datong, MediaTek. We got lots of manufacturers, and they are invisible. They also have a good tie to with the Apples and Googles. So we know that, the problem is that we don't know the technology evolution, and we are not a technician, but we certainly know that we open that our government. And that would be the better way to have the more efficiency can be concurred. Yeah,
well, thank you. Of course, you have Triple I, which is the major technology provider. I had the pleasure to work with them and also to work in Taipei for some projects. And what I saw there was also something that you're referring to, which is this co-creation with citizens and with end users. And in Taiwan, this was very easy. So it was very logical for projects to go into the neighborhood and to talk to people and work with people and try to get them to express what they could want or what they would want to do. And so I'm also working in European projects and I'm community manager for Novi Sad and Santander, and these are the two main smart cities, I would say, in Europe. And to a certain extent, Santander has the most nodes, it has the most sensors in the city. And Novi Sad has the most cameras. It has an optical grid, which is. So we're building use cases, of course, and but even in these sort of very serious and very recent projects, I found that basically all the projects that we do in Europe at the moment have use cases built by engineers. So the use cases are described by the engineers at the beginning of the project. Then it comes into the description of work, which is somehow holy and so cannot be changed. And I had to do co-creation workshops first with the researchers of the universities in the project before they would allow me to go next to their citizens. And then even they would try to give me associations of people to talk and not the real citizens to a certain extent. And this was not their fault, because they were very good, nice, and decent researchers, but they were simply not, they cannot simply, engineers basically cannot simply believe that they can get information or data from ordinary people. And it's like, it's a very difficult, so.
Well, maybe that's in culture as well. I see it on the work floor. In the Netherlands, I don't think that you will find it everywhere in the world, but when an engineer is coming to the work floor and a blue collar is saying, well, there's a print that he has to do, and a blue collar is saying, this is not come to work. You are using the wrong materials, and the specification is not correct. Then an engineer in the Netherlands is going back to his office and think, wow, maybe he's right. In most of the countries in the world, they will say, well, you're fired. To the blue collar. And this is something that we have to be more, well, it will be more common in the future, because creativity is not only, and knowledge is not only in the top, there will be more spread. And we really have to change this attitude. Yeah. About your questions about the 1992, the introduction of internet, it lasts a long time, because you were giving some examples about Facebook and that kind of applications, but they are only from the last years. And the same is with Manuel Castells. It's from 1995, his book of the Network Society. And at last, now 20 years later, we are going to start with it. So I'm very confident about the fact that we will implement Internet of Things, and it will be far more faster than the Internet as we have seen before. But still, on the other hand, I want to do it on a solid way. And the solid way is that we need to bring in the other, in the co-creation process, the other stakeholders as well. Otherwise, it will not be successful, I presume. And that's why we need some time. Because, and this, I just found out, I was telling you about technology and about privacy and confidentiality in the McKinsey report. And then I thought, whoa,
you're not going to McKinsey, right?
No, it's a good report, but they missed people as well. There is nothing about citizens here. It's a technological report as well.
Yeah.
So what you can see, you were saying about the United States, that corporates will go on without government, and I see so.
Yeah.
So what they are doing, for example, I gave the last couple of days the example about Google and PayPal, Peter Thiel and Eric Schmidt and Tim Draper, and even Bill Gates on this moment, that they are saying we can organize society better than the government. So you are blocking innovation, that kind of things. But is this true? It is not true. Because when I look to the United States, and especially when I look to Silicon Valley, it's the highest density of beggars in the Western world. So they can make technology, but they cannot implement it on a way that society will be improved. So we have to find the middle of the road. You can use data to put a society in control, or you can use data to make money with it. And I prefer to be more in the middle, and that we improve society, including the opinion of the people there for the development.
Yes, with good entrepreneurship. So that doesn't bite each other.
It doesn't bite each other. I think it's better, because when I'm very much interested in the commercial interest of a corporate. Of course they have to make money. Yeah. But I hope that they are a little bit interested in our public interest, what we want to do with the people, and the people what they want to hear. And that's their market as well. It's just exactly what you would say. You cannot pass these people and implement some technological products, and maybe it will be a success, but maybe not. So we have to be more inclusive, and you can see it on large corporates. I'm not the only one in our region who's saying so, but you can see that Philips is saying this kind of things, and other huge corporates in Europe, that they say it must be inclusive, otherwise we are going to develop new and expensive devices that will not be used. And it would be a pity.
And I think you're starting to tease out one of the questions around what are kind of the talents we're going to need to actually leverage some of the IoT capabilities to really unlock the value. And you know, you highlight an engineer that is spending years being trained on problem solving. Well, that's fine if you have a clearly defined problem, but may not be as good if you're trying to envision what's possible. So you need to actually tap into someone who's on the ground experiencing something saying, wouldn't it be nice if it's possible to do this? That's your blue collar person who's actually living and breathing. And I think the smart city environment, the reason I think it's so powerful is you've got a great mix of people all connected around real experience. And I think the reason Silicon Valley's been effective is they observe problems, they figure out how to innovate around solving those problems. But those are problems of a city 7 by 7, 7 miles by 7 miles. All the cities in the planet, you've got half the people, you know, on the planet. You've got lots of different diverse problems, so I think unlocking that value is important. So I think part of the smart city initiative also needs to think about how do I attract the right talent to help me unlock this skill set? And it is multidisciplined. It's going to take government planners with vision. It's going to take corporates who can actually figure out how to make that financially sustainable. It's going to take the people who sit down and figure out how do I actually experience this and make it work. And I think the cities that are going to be successful are starting to invest in programs to help attract that talent. And I look at the smart city world almost in the same way that the introduction of ports had an influence on economics back in the 1700s. It's a way to create an environment that has a better environment for success, better access to services, better access to talent, and I can use that to attract the kind of talent to really lead. The one encouragement I would say is that I don't feel as much that these cities are true competitors, so they're actually willing to collaborate. And that means we've got half the planet willing to collaborate around solving problems. If you solve a problem in Taipei, maybe we want to learn from it and use it locally. If we do something here, let's share it with Europe. And that power, that unlocking it, I think is powerful.
That's really great. I mean, this is really great analysis, and I think you have to write it down and become the new Richard Florida, right? Because this is basically what Richard Florida made his book on. Yeah. The very, very simple analysis of a particular mix of people that would then attract, and he then took it into the world for a decade, and cities invested in that. So this is, I think, is something that maybe we all have to write down and become the next Richard Florida.
Well, read the book of Bain and Barber. It's about connectivity within the city and connectivity between cities, and how that is being blocked by national governments as well. So our collaboration is rather tough to do. We are working quite intensively together with Taipei and Waterloo and the Canadian Technological Triangle, and that's great. But if I want to learn something from Taipei, then it must be according to our national legislation as well. For example, I see in some places here, I wanted to implement UberPop in Eindhoven. And that's due to regulation completely forbidden. And although I do not want to have UberPop, I want to have a transition from the present taxi branch to a new one. And that is more controlled, it's beneficial for the people. I don't know, when I pick a taxi in Eindhoven, then he can drive around. And it can cost me a lot of money. I cannot control it. And with UberPop, you just say, I go to that place. It's GPS controlled. You can drive around, but the charge will not change. So it's great. It will be exactly on the front side. It will be given to you. This will be what you have to pay. And there is a very huge benefits for the people who are going to use it. And the national government is not going to allow it.
So this is part of the silent takeover by the mayors, right? Sort of in a way that you have to be able to bypass these types of solutions in a very creative way. Maybe there's other questions in the audience? Because if there are, yes, please. Is there a mic? Please.
Hi. Okay. How quickly will all this data become socialized so that instead of me being able to connect a few devices myself and build an app, that I can build an app that is based on the data that is being connected? In that, not so much that once the cities and obviously the cities that are connecting us are the most progressive socially as well, I think. So I don't think we have anything to fear there. You rely on governments to legislate on issues of national security and of personal security so that you can get on with what you're doing. But at what point will the Internet of Things consortiums and the industry itself develop the protocols that once in the same way that Google uses freemium to give away stuff, when will I be able to use the data about people traveling on public transport so that I can build apps around it? When will we give away that free currency away from the organizations that own it now and socialize it for us all to have? And are there any protocols that will allow us to do that soon or immediately?
So my observation is that there are cities that have already made available public data sets and actually made that very accessible. So you can do that in Singapore, you can do that in Taipei, you can do that in many cities already where they've made data available. How you manage the availability of data and the privacy concerns is a very important aspect of getting access to that. But some of that's already possible today. When we talk about IoT as vertical solution sets, right, a solution set for smart water and for transport and for different things, those inevitably become silos that are very difficult and challenging. So I think having that horizontal layer of data exchange is going to be essential to really make that possible. And some cities have become very progressive and you can do that today, others have not. My observation says if we think about it as a design problem and say, how do I make sure the data is usable but is not exposing privacy and sensitive data inappropriately, if I can design around that problem, we'll actually encourage more sharing. I think our message is to a lot of companies, even within a company, you've got data that is in silos within different units of a company. And what we tell them is, this data is a corporate asset, and it's only valuable if you share it. Well, if I look in cities, you've got many data pockets in individual ministries and companies, etc., and we have to unlock, take that same principle and encourage them to actually open that up. So the technology's there, but I don't think the behaviors and the design models are around that to make it universally accessible today.
Yes, things are changing in this way. So there, for example, the Singapore Manufacturing Association, if you want to become part of that, you have to open up all your data to all the members. Otherwise, you simply cannot be part of it. So they use brute force in that sense to make sure that everybody's opening up all the data set, because it's a win-win-win-win situation. But it will take some time. Maybe you want to also...
Yeah, so I think the as you've mentioned, the cities are trying to do our part. So I think the easy part, but it's still extremely valuable, is are data that's already anonymized in its nature and I can make open. So if you go to our open data website, you can download the REST data, the real-time data, and you can download the APIs as well to build your apps. The less easy part, but still doable, and I think it alludes to what you say about the architecture, is really being able to have that kind of identity management to be able to allow you to allow your data to be used for whatever purpose it can be. And that need not be government asking you, it could be a company asking you for your data and so on, to have that interface to allow for this protocol, this exchange, this permissioning to happen. I think the elephant in the room is that it's not the government that has most of your data, it's companies. And really, we need to figure out that conversation. It's not just IoT companies, software companies, Google, Facebook, and so on. And we do need to have that kind of that conversation to figure out how we are able to make better use of this data. Because I think if you add it up, it's probably 99% of what, it's probably like 990 times what government has.
And to me, that's talking about some of the evolution in the business models that are coming. Because if I can define a business model that makes it win-win for each participant to share, then I'm going to get them willing to do that. If it's just an extra cost to share it, or it's a way for me to surrender potential future revenue or other things, I'm going to be very discouraged. So we need to design and really recraft some of the business models to help encourage that sharing. But the good news is that can actually come from citizens in some cases, not even from governments. I mean, one of the cities in the U.S., they knew that they wanted to increase the services available from the government, but they didn't have an increasing budget. So they actually made a strategic decision to share their data and then open up that data to citizens to develop applications on that data. And over the course of a three-year window, they had 200 new services available against that public data that the government didn't have to fund out of its own private funding. So they found a business model that actually made that attractive for people to participate and try to build new apps on that public data. We need to think through the business models. And there's not a single business model that's going to work. There's going to be multiple issues. The financial companies also have a lot of data. Financial companies, telcos, both have data. They both want to use that to unlock some value, but they're reticent to share in some cases. So we need to help work through those models.
Any more questions so far? Yeah.
Well, one thing I think might be worth talking about is, since we're talking about execution, some of the key factors that are consistent in cities that are actually very successful in unlocking some of this value in the smart city model. My observation, at least in looking through many of the different cities that have gone through these initiatives, there are two challenges. The brand new cities that are starting out with no legacy can do some very interesting things because they're brand new. And so we've had, you know, brand new cities built out in China that were designed day one under a smart city, you know, sort of construct. And they can do something very different than an established city that needs to retrofit. So obviously making some of the choices is different if you're starting from scratch or you're starting from a very established space. But some of the consistent things I see, incentives around research and development and grants and things that actually encourage companies to participate in that environment and actually unlock the value. I think that's important. Investments in the skills and actually attracting the right skills to participate in this space. Connections with the institutes of higher learning where you actually encourage them. And that's one of the things I really like and admire about what Singapore is doing, trying to get Smart Nation as a national asset. Let's get the schools involved in this. Let's get companies involved in this. Let's get government involved in this, in building a national asset. And that vision, I think, that strong vision of sharing, I think, is very successful. You talked about open data exchange. I mentioned as well this open participation with citizens through things like hackathons and other things like that. And then a clear focus around outcomes. If you don't have a clear focus on the problems you're trying to solve, you'll spend a lot of money without a lot of outcome. So, you know, we need to get those articulated. But those are some of the things I see. I guess in Taipei's case, what do you see as some of the key ingredients to the success you see?
The other thing is the intergovernmentality. I'm using the term intergovernmentality. Is the most important thing is try to make better cooperation among the agency. So I'm using the words intergovernment cooperation. Well, that was most important things in terms of for facilitating the smart city programs, that we need to have more cooperation among the city agency. So taking one of the example that we want to have to promote community health care, you know, from the Department of Health. And the other way is we have to have the civil agency that they will detecting of the local business. So they have to have more cooperation. And the third forces will be the Department of the Technology. So they have to work together. So that is why I'm also see there's a critical component that made the initiative of smart city get better. The second thing is I also totally agree with what Robert had mentioned there. We're also facing the problem of the procurement law. So in terms of the smart city, it is always out of law. Out of law. So I invented that we should have the most test that the political will and the setting up the PMO of the smart city is trying to avoid the interrupt of the procurement law. But it always has been expected by the different agency, whether you are doing right or wrong. So there will be another component they have to invent a new models of a procurement, especially from the public service. So that will be the quite key component.
This is something, Charles, where we are partners. Yeah. We are facing this all over the world, all together. On all the cities, a Johnson in London, you can name them all, they're all facing the same problem. Because if you want to do something new, innovative. And you are so right, it's always, yeah, not according to the existing law. So how are we going to deal this? And this is something we have to bring up and to organize. So the world standards are important, but we have to do some other things as well. And it's rather difficult. I don't know what you are doing in your consultancy to advise to city governments how they have solved this problem. We try to do it in procurement procedure with what we call a procurement by dialogue. The question is if the European Union is going to approve this, but maybe you can give some answer about this.
I mean, this goes back to the business model question, you know, that we talked about earlier, because traditional procurement models around, I've got a service, I'm going to send it out to tender for a certain number of things, I'm going to go do this. How do you do that in an experiment world where we don't know what the return on investment is, we don't know the model that's in place, how do I encourage that? So a couple things we do. A, we don't try to solve world hunger all at once, right? We're not going to solve all of procurement for everywhere. Let's talk about the specific initiatives in an area. So, you know, in Singapore, maybe we focus on let's unlock the ministries and how they can help tackle a problem once together. And so we'll actually work through the constituents to have that discussion. In some cases, that requires you to change the law, right? And you got to actually do that from within through the stakeholders. But in a corporate space, I don't have quite that same issue. Usually I'm talking about corporate policies, not around government policy, so I have a bit more autonomy about that. In a government space, I think transparency is going to be key, because a lot of the procurement stuff is about actually transparency to make sure there's an effective spend of public dollars. If we can find a way to make that transparency available, we're not actually against the spirit of the
It's possible.
Regulation.
I tried it out a couple of years ago. I wanted to do something new. It was with our transport system. And then I asked, is this possible? And then they said, yeah, you can do this with this corporate. But the only reason that you can do this is that they can provide something that is really new and it is not available anywhere else in the market. So I have to give evidence on it. And then I wrote down a formula, and it has to be sent to Brussels, and it lost 1.5 years before they gave an improvement. Yep. Well, this will not work. Yep. This is real, this is real life.
And it affects speed, right? Because that innovation, if you have that drag of tradition, is very hard, which is why encouraging and finding a way to support experimentation is key. Some of the hackathon things, which are not a cost procurement-based question, but a service-based model, changes the nature of the equation. We actually helped a company say, we want to do something with Internet of Things. How do we do that? We helped them host a hackathon. Turns out the person who won the hackathon was an employee of the company. It was the only time they'd had a chance to actually try this idea out. So it was actually a way to break down some of the barriers in their own organization just by changing the nature of how we procured the services.
I want to add that your point about having the correct business model is very apt, because we are talking about this from a government perspective, and the government wants transparency, the government wants value for money, wants to know its taxpayers' dollars are used correctly, and that's all what the government wants. But the other party is the corporate, and the corporate is going to look at you and it's going to say, you want me to build one smart lift for you? No, I want to build for the whole of Singapore. Yeah. And there has to be an arrangement in which it makes sense for the corporate company to innovate with you, take the risk with you, and if you know it reaches a certain milestone or something, there's value for them, there's sustainable value for them. You can't expect companies to be charitable in that regard. Yeah, so it's about building that model of collaboration.
And that's where some of the government grants that actually help that co-investment can actually help reduce some of those barriers. You're right.
But the right of experiments is key in this case. And that is what Charles is saying as well. If we don't get the space to do new experiments, then we will remain blocking innovation.
Agree. Yeah.
So this is something we have to come up with all together. And I can understand. But when I ask for an experiment, then Amsterdam will say, so we want to do Rotterdam, Paris, Vienna. And then everywhere there is no existing legislation anymore. So I see that problem. But on the other hand, we have to do something different than we did in the past. Yeah. And the main problem is here that the world is really disruptively changing, and all the procedures and the positions and the role of the governmental side remain the same.
Would you say that China was then very far ahead in creating these kind of free zones of sort of that they would actually would that be a kind of a was that very smart to do?
Deputy Mayor Lin would know more about knows most about China than I do.
I keep silent. Okay.
Very good. Well, I don't want to end on sort of keeping silent. So, because I think we had a very, very lively and very good discussion. I really believe we had tackled some very good questions. I want to thank you for showing up in such a huge number. And can I get a really fantastic applause for my speakers here?